Hello everyone. I had a very interesting day yesterday. I went to watch a football match. It was a very exciting match. But suddenly, a few members of the two teams got into an argument. From a verbal argument, it became a physical fight between the two team members. Things would have turned ugly and the match would have had to be abandoned if the referee hadn't stepped in and resolved the matter. The referee intervened and showed the red card to one of the players and sent him off the field. He also had a talk with the two captains and the coaches of the two teams. Only then the game resumed. A lot of time got wasted in all this. It made me realize how important a role the various officials like the referee, the umpire, the linesman, etc. play in any match, be it football, volleyball, cricket, tennis, etc. This line of thinking went further and I thought if two players, two teams, small groups needed an official to oversee things and to maintain the rules and decorum, then with so many countries in the world having many languages, different lifestyles, varied geographical features, etc., there would definitely be a need for not one official but a large body of officials to oversee the working of nations and to ensure that peace and progress is maintained in the world. The institution or organization which does this very important duty is called the United Nations Organization or the UNO. Today, let's get to know more about the UNO from a discussion between Mr. Samir Thadkar, Special Envoy to the UNO, and Ms. Naina Singh, reporter with the famous newspaper, The World Times.
It's a pleasure to be here and meet you, Ms. Naina. I admire your reporting. You have written some excellent articles in The World Times.
Thank you for the welcome and for the kind words, Mr. Samir. You are the right person as the special envoy to answer a few questions regarding the UNO. Can you give me a brief idea about its background and its objectives?
The UNO was founded in 1945 after the Second World War. It replaced the earlier organization, the League of Nations. It came into effect to stop wars among nations and to have a platform for a dialogue between nations. Its broad aims are to promote international security, help economic and social development of member countries, to protect rights and liberties of people and nations, to provide world peace and progress, etc. The term United Nations was first coined by the US President Franklin D. Roosevelt. The UNO officially came into existence on 24th October 1945. So, 24th October every year is celebrated as UN Day.
So it's like a world government and makes rules for all the countries.
No, it's not like a world government. It does not make laws or impose taxes. The UNO started with 51 member countries and at last count it has 193 member countries. The only condition for membership is that the country has to accept the objectives of the UNO and establish world peace. It works with the cooperation of all the member nations. The map shows how, from 1945 to date, the countries of the world have become members of the UNO.
Oh, that makes it very clear. It's a voluntary body of the countries of the world. Where is it located? And how do all these 193 countries work together?
From every member country, representatives are sent to the UNO to help in its functioning. All member countries make an annual financial contribution to meet the expenses of the UNO. It has its headquarters at Lake Success, New York City. There are six official languages of the UNO. These are English, French, Spanish, Russian, Arabic and Chinese. A delegate can speak in any of these languages. There will be an automatic simultaneous translation to the other official languages. Special arrangements are also made if a delegate wants to make a speech in any other language, for example, Hindi.
That's very convenient. So even if a French delegate speaks in French, a Chinese delegate can hear the speech in Chinese, a language he is comfortable with. And so, this will minimize any chances of misunderstanding occurring due to language and not being understood. It must be very difficult to get any work done with 193 members and so many different issues to be dealt with, like ensuring peace, removal of poverty, protecting rights, etc. So the UNO is one big body.
The UNO is one body made up of member nations. But just like the human body, it has many organs. These organs ensure the smooth and effective working of the UNO. The UNO has six main organs. These are the General Assembly, the Security Council, the Secretariat, the International Court of Justice, the Economic and Social Council, and the Trusteeship Council. Of these, the first five are functioning. The sixth has no role today. Let's examine each of these. The General Assembly. It is the main deliberative body of the UN. All member countries of the UNO are members of the General Assembly. Each country sends one representative to the General Assembly. All members have one vote. Its meetings are held once every year and each member country sends its representative to these meetings. Matters of common interest are discussed and debated at these meetings of the General Assembly. The views expressed by the members are kept in mind and used as guidelines for the working of the UN. The sessions are held under the leadership of the President of the General Assembly. They look at issues like elections of members to various organs, admission or suspension of member countries, etc. The second organ is the Security Council. It is the most important organ as it can adopt compulsory resolutions. It has the responsibility to maintain world peace. It averts or tries to avert the danger of war. At the hint of a war between two countries, it steps in to try and resolve the issue and negotiate for peace. The Security Council listens to complaints of member nations against other members. Its method of working includes peacekeeping, peace enforcement missions, and also uses other means to bring pressure on dissenting countries using measures like trade embargo or trade stoppage, etc. It has 15 member countries. Of these, 5 are permanent members. These are United States of America, United Kingdom, People's Republic of China, France, and Russia. These countries have the veto power. All 5 have to agree. Only then a resolution is passed. The other 10 countries are non-permanent members. These 10 seats are filled by election in the General Assembly for a period of 2 years.
That means the Security Council plays a very important role in peacekeeping. I have written about the role of the UN peacekeeping forces in the Congo region earlier and recently in Iran and Iraq. When I was writing an article about the present Secretary General, I did a lot of research into the Secretariat, which is another important organ of the UNO. The Secretariat is the administrative organ of the UNO. It is responsible for the day-to-day working of the UN. It is headed by the Secretary General. He is helped by hundreds of other officials. The Secretary General is elected by the General Assembly. There have been 8 Secretary Generals so far. The present Secretary General is Mr. Ban Ki-moon of South Korea. He assumed office on 1st January 2007. It has its headquarters in New York City. This has been declared as international territory. It also has 3 main offices in Geneva, Nairobi, and Vienna.
That's great information, Nana. The Secretary General is the de facto spokesman and leader of the UN. Mr. Ban Ki-moon is now in his second term of office. His term will end in 2016. The role of the Secretary General has also been described as a world moderator. We will now proceed to the fourth organ, that is the International Court of Justice. It has its headquarters at The Hague in Netherlands. It has 15 judges. It hears cases of violation of international law. It has heard cases of war crimes, illegal state interference, etc.
When I visited the Netherlands, I had gone to the Hague Way. It's an imposing building. It's called the Peace Palace at the Hague Way.
The fifth and the last working organ is the Economic and Social Council. It helps the General Assembly in promoting international economic and social cooperation and development. It has 54 members. A president is chosen from among these. It looks after the working of various commissions under the UN, like the Human Rights Commission, the Commission to Eradicate Poverty, Illiteracy, etc. It also coordinates with various specialized agencies of the UN. Its main aim is to improve the general standard of living. The sixth organ, that is the Trusteeship Council, is non-functional now. It was created to look after the affairs of the countries that were not independent. All these countries have become free nations and members of the UNO. It is inactive since 1994, when the last trust territory of Palau gained independence in 1994.
These organs are of utmost importance in the effective working of the UNO. These organs of the UN are also very ably assisted by the various important specialized agencies. There are many such agencies. I have done some work with the UNICEF. The United Nations International Children's Emergency Fund was set up after the Second World War to help mothers and children affected by the war. Now it runs and helps out with many centers spread all over the world. Its main areas of work are to provide medical advice, food and medicines to mothers and children in developing countries, etc. It gets greeting cards designed and made by local artists and agencies. The money got from the sale of the UNICEF greeting cards help fund its activities.
I too have bought UNICEF greeting cards during Christmas and New Year.
In India, the UNICEF has helped in running the Anganwadis. Here, mothers are given advice and training on child care and nutrition. Many Anganwadis also look after the children of very poor parents. For any country, its population is its greatest resource and asset. So the health of the people is of great importance. In this area, the work of the World Health Organization is exceptional.
The World Health Organization, or WHO, is another specialized agency. It works to prevent diseases like polio, tuberculosis, malaria, etc. Due to its efforts, smallpox has been totally eradicated. It works to create awareness about major diseases like AIDS, etc. It organizes exchange programs for doctors so that they are familiar with progress in the medical field in different countries. In case of an epidemic in any member country, its team of doctors help out to contain the epidemic. Another specialized agency is the Food and Agriculture Organization, or FAO. Its main aim is to promote knowledge of improved methods of farming. During times of food scarcity and famine, it distributes food in those areas. It has helped spread awareness among member nations about pest control and other plant diseases. Its motto is Freedom from hunger.
I have read about the excellent work done to preserve heritage sites around the world. When I had visited the pyramids of Giza in Egypt, I learned that it is a UNESCO protected World Heritage Site. Can you tell us more about the working of the UNESCO?
The United Nations Educational, Scientific and Cultural Organization, or UNESCO, helps students and teachers from one country go to other countries and gain knowledge. It helps the member nations protect and preserve their cultural heritage. Scientists are encouraged to share their researches under UNESCO programs. In India, there are many UNESCO protected sites like the Agra Fort. Delhi as a heritage city, the Ajanta, Ellora and the Elephanta Caves, etc.
Yes, the UNESCO is doing excellent work in the field of cultural preservation. On the whole, the various organs and specialized agencies of the UN have been very effective in their areas of work. Let me quickly share with a few outstanding achievements of the UN. It has helped in resolving disputes or any other issue and so has averted an outright war. This ensured that small fights did not escalate into major wars. It has sent peacekeeping missions that are the UN peacekeeping force to Korea, West Asia, Congo, that's Africa, Cyprus, Palestine, Iraq, and Iran. For its great work in the area of peacekeeping, it was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize in 1988. Other agencies who have won similar awards or recognitions are the UN High Commission for Refugees, the UNICEF, the International Labour Organization. In all areas of life, the UN is doing yeoman service.
Thanks to a very enlightening discussion between Mr. Sameer and Ms. Naina, we have got a very good idea about the UNO and its role in world affairs. The key lies in the hands of all the member nations now to ensure a peaceful and progressive world for future generations. Can we all make a poster and a slogan each to promote peace, health and happiness? With this, we come to the end of our lesson. I thank you and wish you all a beautiful world. Let's take a pledge to make the world a better place for all the people of the world. Till we meet again, happy learning and take care of yourself.